Okay, let's get started. Low turnout today because everyone's hungover from the weekend, but we'll go into it. So the first thing I want to discuss is sort of some administrative things as we finish up the semester. The first is the reminder that we're having the final exam in class next week on Wednesday. And the basic layout of the exam will be sort of three short answer questions, short essay questions. So it's not going to be like this multiple choice thing where, like, you know, does MVCC do this? Does OCC do that? Right? I'm looking for you guys to have you guys sort of synthesize a bunch of the different lectures that we've, you know, topics and things we talked about in the class, and sort of ask more higher-minded questions of, like, how do you, you know, combine these things and how do the different pieces of the things that we talked about in the class interoperate? And so I realized that this may be kind of different than what you're used to in most classes. And so what I'll do is provide you later this week sort of two sample questions of what I'm sort of going for in the exam. And that'll give you an idea of like how to prepare and how to study. So the basic idea is like, if you follow along the lectures, if you're mostly familiar with the papers that we talked about when we assigned the readings, then you should be able to answer these questions, right? So again, there's not gonna be like, if you miss this one lecture, you can't answer the question. It's gonna be, you know, the question is gonna be designed to encompass topics across a lot of different things we talked about. So again, I'll provide the sample later in the week. Then the second thing is that the final exam, during the final exam period that we have, during the exam period, we will do the final presentations of your projects. And I'm putting final in quotes because the final exam was on May 6th, but your actual code drop for the projects are not due until May 11th. So it doesn't necessarily have to have everything done on this date. And so it'll be 10 minutes per group, sort of the same thing we did last class. And by the way, I felt like the presentations you guys did last class were excellent. The demos were really awesome, and I'm really excited to see how everyone's progressing. So this time, instead of having 5 minutes, we'll have 10 minutes per group. We'll let Prashant go first, because he always gets cut off at the end. And we'll get some pizza for everyone, so there'll be food. And then I'm getting donations from the different database companies that there'll be prizes for everyone. So there'll be like a grand prize for whoever we vote to be the best project of the class, but then everyone else gets a consolation prize, like t-shirts and shit like that. So we have items donated from Snowflake DB, VoltDB, NeoDB, MongoDB, Splice Machine, and I think one more other, the names escaped me. So there'll be stuff for everyone. And then the other thing I'll point out is that I've bumped up the due date for the code reviews to be May 8th after the final presentations. Prior to this, they were due on May 1st. But I realized that everyone's gonna sort of be rushing at the end to write a bunch of code and prepare for this. So in between the final presentation and then when you actually have to provide me the source code, you guys are required to do this code review. You can do it beforehand. Right? It doesn't necessarily have to be done on this date, but this is when everything has to be done. And I'll talk about what's expected and what the guidelines are for doing the code review in next class. And then I'll announce the pairings for the group. So each group will be assigned to another group, and it's your job to look at their code and provide suggestions. And this is the same kind of thing you would do when you go out in the real world and work on a large software company. All right, so any questions about all these things? Okay, and there's also the extra credit stuff as well. The website is almost done, and so hopefully we'll have that ready for you guys this week as well. And it's not meant to be, you know, very taxing or stressful. It's just to be, you know, sort of enhancing your own education about what's out there in the real world. Okay, the other thing I want to point out is last class I made a comment that Pivotal bought the Wisconsin Quick Step system. And I said, well, I don't really know what they're doing with it. There hasn't been any announcement, or I didn't know what their plans are for it. But it actually turned out, only a few weeks ago, Pivotal announced that they're making Quickstep open source, and they've submitted it as an Apache incubation project. So the idea is here that now they're actually going to try to build something that's, you know, people can use as part of the Apache ecosystem. So this is the link to the proposal. And they're also, in these comments too, they also talk about how they're building a distributed version of the Quickstep system as well, which I thought was kind of interesting. I actually don't know what they intend to do with this because Pivotal obviously also owns Greenplum, right? And that's their sort of massively parallel data warehouse. Quickstep is meant to be used for a data warehouse, so I don't really see how the two are gonna be used together or whether they're conflicting or what the deal is. So that's just something to note. Actually, somebody on Twitter pointed that out, and so I wanted to correct it. All right, so for today's class, what we're going to talk about is dealing with databases that exceed the amount of memory that's available to the system. So pretty much for the entire semester, we've been just assuming that, oh, our database is going to fit exactly into DRAM. And yes, we have to be careful about how we pull things into our CPU caches and where we place the data on our different DIMMs. But now we're actually going to deal with databases that exceed the amount of DRAM that's available. And we'll talk about how can we actually bring back spinning disk hard drives, SSDs, and other things without slowing down all the good stuff that we've achieved with our in-memory optimized execution engines and systems. So let's talk about the background of why this is hard and what the challenges we're going to face. And then I'm going to spend time talking about the different things you have to consider, things you have to solve when you actually implement this in an in-memory database system. And then I'll talk about some real-world examples that actually do some of these things. And we'll finish off with an evaluation of sort of taking these implementation issues and seeing what the trade-offs are then for different workloads. All right, so the motivation of why we want to do this is quite kind of obvious, right? DRAM is very fast compared to like a spinning disk hard drive, an SSD, but it's also very expensive, and its capacity is quite limited. So I think the best you can do now is you can buy a 32 gigabyte DIMM. All right, so you can have one stick of RAM have up to 32 gigabytes of DDR4. All right, so that means that in order to have a really large database, you would have to have a motherboard that has a lot of DIMM slots in order to scale up for that size. But obviously, DRAM is also more expensive than a spinning disk hard drive or an SSD. And not just in terms of actually buying the hardware itself, but then when you actually run it in your system, it's actually very expensive. And so there's been reports that says for the total amount of energy that should be used to power a server, 40% of the energy is being used to refresh DRAM, right? Because every so often they have to cycle through and add power in order to maintain the charge in all of the DRAM. So 40% of their power is just being spent on updating DRAM over and over again. So it'd be really nice if our database system could use the cheaper storage devices that are out there, but without having to slow down all the in-memory stuff that we can do. So this is sort of what our today's lecture is about. And so the basic idea of the high-level goal, again, is we want to be able to store and access data on disk, but without having to bring back all of the disk-oriented stuff that I disparaged and said was slow in the beginning of the semester. Remember, I showed that pie chart that said like 30% of the time was spent in the buffer pool manager, 30% of the time was in the log manager, 30% of the time was in the concurrency control, and they only left around 12% of CPU cycles available to the database system to actually execute queries. So we want to bring back disk storage without killing ourselves and slowing ourselves down the way that the disk-oriented guys are. And so to do this, we need to be very careful about how we're going to access this secondary storage. And we need to be mindful what the access method or the API we're going to use, right? So when we had an in-memory database system, when all the tuples were in memory, we would have this tuple-oriented storage architecture. Right, we had our indexes point to exact addresses in memory for the tuples where the tuples are located. Our concurrency control scheme was based on this as well. We could have pointers from one tuple to the next. We could do chaining for multi-version concurrency control. So when everything's in memory, we can be completely tuple-oriented. But when we bring back these slower disk devices, they don't allow that sort of same fine-grained access. Instead, they're going to have these block-based APIs where you can read and write 4 kilobytes at a time. You can still read a single tuple, but you're not going to go just grab that one tuple you want. You have to go get the 4 kilobyte block that the tuple is located in. So in our architecture, we need to be mindful of this and make sure that we make decisions as we bring back disk to account for this, because otherwise we can end up with a lot of problems. So for this class, we're mostly going to be talking about OLTP, but I'm going to talk a little bit about how to bring back disk for an OLAP system. So there's not much we can actually do or exploit in our workload or application to get around the slowness of disk. And this is because when you think of these OLAP queries, again, they're doing full table scans or maybe a subset of the attributes that you have, but you're basically just scanning from beginning to end. There's not really a lot of optimizations you can do to get around that. You're sort of going at the speed of reading things from disk. So you can still do all the vectorization, the query compilation stuff that we talked about before, and those other optimizations, compression and things like that, but you're still going to have to go fetch those blocks and bring it in. Right? So there's not much we can do to get around that. The only technique that I know of that people use is to maintain some metadata in memory about what is actually on disk. And the idea is that hopefully you can have queries that can just be processed and using the metadata that's in memory without having to go get the actual items on disk. So what I mean by that, let's say you have a table that has a column A, and this is sort of just the logical scheme of it. So the way we would lay this out physically is that in memory we would have these pages that would correspond to pre-computer aggregations on this column. So the min, the max, the average, count, standard deviation, all those other things you would normally execute in a query for all the data within that, within a single block. And then out on disk, we maintain the block itself. So the idea is that if we have a select star query for this column, or sorry, select count star query, then rather than going and getting the actual page and reading it and doing the count, we would just do a lookup here in memory and look at the pre-computed aggregation. So we avoid having to go read things from disk. So this is what MemSQL does, but I would say that this is not actually unique to in-memory storage, right? Vertica does this as well. They just have the pre-computed stuff just be in the header of the disk page. So you just read the header, and maybe you don't have to read the rest of the data. Right, so there's nothing precluding a disk-based system from making the same optimization, but it's something we can apply in an in-memory system. For OLTP,
Has this been considered already? For example, if disk is cheap, why not have two copies of the data, one where you store it in its actual place, and the other copy where the entire table is a log? And so if you want to do an OLAP query, you just blaze through the log in a sequential manner, and then it's an OLTP query, you actually go to the actual location and get it.
So his statement is, what if you had say a table on disk stored as a log?
In a sequential manner, along with it being in its proper place according to the database optimization structures as well. So if you have an OLAP query where you need to read the entire table, you just read sequentially without any seeks in the log place of the table, log copy. And otherwise, you just operate on the regular
So his statement is you have two copies of the database on disk. And one copy is a log, the other copy is a sort of unsorted heap. So a lot of times in the OLAP systems, the disk-oriented ones, the actual table itself is clustered, so it's already stored in sorted order. Right? So MemSQL does this, Vertica does this with the projections. If you use a clustered index, you get the same thing. So there's not really any benefit to having two things, right? You still have to do a sequential scan
disk. What I was saying was, rather than jumping around all over the place, if it was all over the disk surface.
If it's OLTP, yes, you want to avoid that.
Okay.
And so in case of MemSQL, which we'll talk about later on, right? They have the column store out on disk, and they have this metadata for pre-computed in memory. But then they have the row store, or the hot stuff that you're accessing in transactions. That's always in memory, so you never go out to disk. The bottom line is, even if you have a disk-oriented system, when you're doing a transaction, if you ever have to go to disk, you're screwed, right? It's always going to be slow. So usually what happens is you can use a system like MySQL, you just have to give it enough RAM such that the working set size fits in DRAM, right? But again, you still pay the penalty for having the buffer pool manage and all that sort of disk-oriented architecture. What I'm sort of talking about here is we can go get stuff on disk as needed, but we're going to try to avoid the buffer pool and all that stuff. We're going to assume that most transactions will access everything in DRAM, and if we ever to go anything to disk, we can go get it. We'll talk about smart ways of doing that later on. But for OLAP, it's just always just doing sequential scan anyway. Okay, so for OLTP, it's different, and sort of exactly what I just sort of said to him now is we can exploit the fact that most OLTP workloads are bifurcated between hot data and cold data, right? Most of the transactions are going to be doing the reads and writes and modifications on the hot data, and we want to keep that in memory. But then as data ages or data becomes colder, we're going to evict it and push it out to our secondary storage. And we're still going to maintain information in memory about what that data is and where it's located so that if any transaction comes along and tries to access that data, they don't get a false negative where we say we don't have it when we actually do. So the example I've used before that I always really like is eBay. So you think of eBay, when auction starts, say it lasts for 7 days, during that period, you get a lot of transactions that are updating, adding bids. The seller might be modifying the auction itself. There's a lot of traffic and the data is hot, right? So you want to keep that in memory. But then after that 7 days, the auction ends, and the only people that are really coming back and looking at it for the most part are the seller and the bidder. And then after 90 days, eBay purges it and puts it in the backend data warehouse, right? So if we know before that 90-day timeout, we could move the data out to a secondary storage and not pay this huge penalty of having to keep everything in DRAM. So that's sort of the basic idea of what we're trying to do. So I want to go through now an example at a high level of what we're trying to do, and then what I'll show as we go along, all the different questions or things we have to figure out in our implementation in order to make this work. And then we'll go after this and say, what are the different ways we can do this for each of the different questions? So let's say that we have some mechanism in our database system to identify what data is cold, what data we don't think is going to be needed in the future in transactions, and therefore we want to move it out into our cold data storage. For this, we can just assume we have some sort of disk resident hash table. It doesn't matter whether it's an SSD or a spinning disk drive. We'll talk about those issues later. But there's someplace we can store blocks of data. All right, so say what we want to do is then take these cold tuples and we'll move it out into a block. And then the Victor tuple block essentially looks like the slotted pages that we talked about before, where you have a header that says this is where this is the table where this data came from, this is the checksum for it, and then I'm just going to lay out the tuples sort of in sequential order. If your tuples have variable length fields like a varchar or blob, right? Obviously we need to be able to take it from the variable length pool and then inject it into our header as well. So we're going to take all the data we have, not just whatever's in line in the heap here. So now the question we have to deal with is, what are we actually going to put in here, right? Do we need to maintain some metadata that says, we used to have tuple 0, 1, 3, and 4 that used to be in memory, but now it's out on disk, and here's where it's located if you ever need to access it again, right? And then now the question is, well, what is our index actually going to point to? Is, right, before it just pointed to the tuples when they were in memory, but now they've been moved out, what should they point to? Should they point to the tuple themselves? Should they point to an auxiliary data structure that says here's where they're located? Should we just completely remove them? Maybe have another data structure that says this is our evicted tuples? And then say now we have a query that comes along, right? He's doing a lookup on ID and he wants to find tuple 01. But since we know that's out on disk, using some mechanism we're keeping track of these things, we now want to copy it back into memory because we can't have the transaction operate anything that's not in memory. So now the question is, how much data are we going to copy? We're going to copy all the tuples in this block, even though we only needed one of them. And then when we copy it back in, do we always merge it back into the table heap, or do we put it into a temporary buffer and just allow this transaction to execute it and then, or operate on it and then throw it away when it's done, right? So it's not just, you know, it's not just simple as like, oh, I'm gonna copy things in and just put them back in. There's all these other things you have to deal with in order to make this work efficiently, right? Because we're trying to avoid having to have a buffer pool. All right, and then of course, Quinn, the question is, well, what happened with this query when it accessed the tuple? Should we just pause it, install it while we go fetch the thing that we need? Or should we abort it, have a separate background thread, go fetch the data that it needs, and then requeue it and re-execute it when that data is ready, right? In a disk-oriented system, it would stall it, but in sort of some of the main memory systems like HDOR, you may actually want to abort it because it's using a coarse grain concurrency control scheme, and that'll cause all their transactions to wait while you're fetching the data. All right, so these are all the things that we're going to have to deal with. So I'm breaking up these issues into three categories. So the first I call runtime operation. So this is the mechanism that we're going to use as transactions access data and queries access data to keep track of what data that they're using. And that's going to allow us to identify later on when we run out of memory what tuples are cold and we can move them out the disk. And then when we go ahead and do this, we'll talk about when we actually move the data out and then what metadata we're going to keep in memory to keep track of what tuple has been evicted. And then now, when a transaction tries to touch evicted data, we can talk about the policies we're going to use to bring it back in. So we talk about how much data from the block we're going to bring in, what mechanism we're going to use for how we, you know, stopping the transaction or waiting, stalling it to get the data that it needs. And then we'll talk about what can we be smarter about how we decide to bring memory back in. right? Maybe we don't want to bring the entire block all the time. Maybe we only want to bring it back in when we know the tuple is actually hot, right? So we're going to go through each of these one by one. And then, like I said, we'll finish off talking about how real-world systems actually implement all these different issues or different policies. All right, so the first one is doing cold tuple identification. So the first approach is to do what I'll call online identification. And this is where the database system is going to monitor transactions access patterns as they run and maintain some kind of data structure that it can allow to identify here's the hot tuples and here's the cold tuples. The reason why we have to do this is, again, we don't have a buffer pool that would be tracking this kind of information for us, right? In a disk-oriented system, the buffer pool maintains some kind of LRU or ARC or other kind of tracking policies in order to decide that this block is now cold, and therefore, when I need to free up a frame, I can grab that block and evict it and throw it out in order to make space. In our system, when everything was in main memory, we didn't have to worry about this because we didn't have to worry about running out of memory. But now, since we wanted to do this, we have to sort of add the same kind of thing back in, but we don't have a buffer pool anymore, so we need to certainly maintain this stuff ourselves. So the way you can do this is you can maintain your own LRU chain between tuples by embedding pointers in the actual tuple headers themselves. So every single time a transaction accesses a tuple, whether it's a read or a write, you would extract the tuple from the LRU chain and put it in the front. And that way, when it comes time to evict data, you just go grab the back tuples, and you know those guys have not been accessed recently. And the reason why we would embed this metadata directly in the tuples rather than having a separate data structure is that we can avoid cache misses of having to go update the LRU chain, because we have to go touch the tuple anyway, and now since the linked list is embedded in the tuple itself, we don't have a cache miss, you know, going accessing a separate thing. Another approach is to do offline identification, and this is where you sort of maintain an in-memory log of how transactions access tuples, and then you have a separate background thread that comes along and basically computes a histogram or the access frequencies of the different tuples in the same way that we're doing here. So the difference here we have a background thread maintain stuff, and this way we're doing it online. So now once we can identify what tuples are cold, now the next question is, when should we trigger an eviction? And the two approaches to do this are to first have, sorry.
So both the mechanisms are sort of relying on the usage patterns, but they're not relying on other semantics. Like you said, eBay has this constraint that after 90 days they're going to be gone. So is there a way, like, sort of how people encode those things? Or, I mean, you can even think of machine learning approaches, like.
Yeah, so his question is, this is sort of like a hard and fast rule in terms of like exactly how the transactions are using it, but there may be higher level logic in the application itself that says, for example, I know after 90 days I want to purge everything out. So you can think of this as like, this is a mechanism that you'd use, or like my database is growing in size, I need to move stuff out to disk now, because otherwise I'll start thrashing. Or the out-of-memory thing in Linux will kill me. So this is sort of like a fail-safe mechanism before you even get to the higher level logic stuff. I'm not really gonna talk about it here, but there's also sort of other things we've tried where you can maybe be smart about how you package up tuples you write out into blocks. If you can use some kind of machine learning thing to identify that these things are related to each other, or even just foreign keys would tell you this stuff. Like, for Andy's account, here's Andy's orders. Andy hasn't logged in 90 days. Let me just not only move his customer information out, but I'll also move his orders out, right? That's sort of the same kind of thing. That might help. But you can embed directly in the system. The higher level stuff, like the eBay example, needs to be, you have to have a DBA to, you know, invoke these things manually. All right, so the next issue is, when do we actually evict stuff? And as I sort of said to him, how this is mostly going to be used is basically there's a threshold that the administrator defines. It says, when my resident set size of my database in memory gets, you know, near 80% or whatever, my total capacity of DRAM that I have in my system, I'll go ahead and initiate the eviction protocol and start moving state stuff out. And in this case here, because the database system is managing memory and managing things on disk, it has to have a separate background thread to go ahead and move data out. and then update whatever metadata it wants in memory to keep track of what was evicted. The other approach is to use the dreaded mmap, and we're going to use the operating system's virtual memory mechanism to allow, you know, have the operating system decide on its own how to move data out. So this is done in the background. The database system doesn't have to maintain any extra information. And it's really up to the operating system to decide when to do this. And obviously, it can know that, oh, the resident size is getting too big. Let me start moving stuff out. So there'll be one example of how we do this in MemSQL and in a variant of VoltDB that was developed by researchers in Switzerland. And I always deride using mmap, but I think the way the EPFL people do it is actually pretty smart, and we'll see that later on, to avoid sort of having any transaction get a page fault when it tries to access evicted data. Try to minimize the impact of that. All right, so now we get to the next big question of what we're actually going to keep in memory to keep track of what data has been evicted. So the first choice is what I'll call tombstones, and this is basically a special tuple or marker we're going to keep in memory that says there used to be a tuple located here, and it's no longer in memory, but here's the block ID and offset in that block on disk where you can go to get it. So what will happen is when you evict the tuple, you create this new tombstone for it, keeping track of the block ID and the offset, and then you update all the indexes now to point to that tombstone. So then if a transaction comes along and say it does a lookup in the index, it would follow the pointer and realize that it has a tombstone, and therefore the data that it really wants is not there. And I'll show you an example of that in a second. The other approach is to maintain some kind of approximate data structure like a Bloom filter to keep track of what the tuples are, keep track of the tuples used to exist but are no longer in memory. And then if you need to go get the actual tuple, there would be a disk resident index that you have to do a lookup on. And therefore that you have to kind of use the sort of buffer pool like manager to bring the blocks of the disk you need in order to look up the index, find what you want, and then get the actual data that you want. And so the issue with this is that if say you have a query that wants to do a lookup, look up on an index, you'd have to first check the index to see whether it exists. And then you may also have to go check the Bloom filter as well. And the Bloom filter can give you false positives, but it's guaranteed never to give you false negatives. So the Bloom filter might say, yes, the tuple you're looking for is not in memory, but I know it's out on disk. But then when you go look it up on disk in this disk resident index, you'll see that it's actually not there. So you may end up doing more work than you need to when you use Bloom filter, but in exchange, you have less memory than you would of having maintained the entire index. So in this first approach here, all the keys for your evicted tuple have to be in all the indexes for that table. In this case here, we just have that, we have one Bloom filter per index. So this ends up using less memory, but you may again have false positives, but you won't have false negatives. And then the last approach is to use virtual memory, again, the mmap stuff in the last slide. And this is kind of nice because you don't have to maintain anything information about what tuples are missing or what tuples are out on disk, because the OS tracks all that stuff for you internally. And we'll see, again, we'll see how VoltDB or the EPFL version of VoltDB does it in a second. All right, so let's go through the first two examples, the Bloom filter one and the tombstone stuff. We'll start with the tombstone one. All right, so here again, we have our in-memory table heap, and then we have our block-based cold storage. And so first thing we'll do is we'll use either the offline or the online identification to compute the access frequencies of the various tuples, and then we'll identify that these three guys here are the ones that have not been accessed in recent times. So therefore, these are eligible to be evicted. So we'll go ahead and write them out to a block on disk. So now if we're using the tombstone approach, we have to deal with the issue that our index used to point to these tuple locations, right? But now there's nothing there, right? Now these slots end up going back into the free pool, and the database system can reuse them for other queries or other transactions for new tuples. So if we have to update our indexes, because now another transaction might write tuple 10 in here, and our index is still pointing to it, and that would be incorrect. So what we're going to do is we're going to create these tombstone tuples on a separate memory region for the table, and then update all our indexes to now point to them. And again, these tombstone tuples have a block ID and an offset that point to the location out on disk in the cold data storage where you can go find them. All right, so now what happens is a transaction comes along, does an index lookup, follows this pointer, it checks a little flag in the header that, you know, whether it's looking at a tombstone tuple or a real tuple, If it's a real tuple, it processes it just like before. If it's a tombstone tuple, then it knows it needs to go fetch the data from disk. And again, there's different policies that decide whether you just you stall and wait while you go fetch it, or you can abort and restart it and fetch it in the background. So obviously, the thing we have to be worried about is if our, say this block ID is a 32-bit integer and the offset's a 32-bit or a 16-bit integer, if our tuple is, if our real tuple is smaller than the tombstone, then we're not really gaining anything here, right? Furthermore, if there's a ton of indexes, remember I said before, in some cases for OLTP workloads, it can be up to 50% or more than 50% of the actual memory usage of a table or a database can be all in indexes, then we're not really gaining that much here, right? If our indexes are very narrow and we have a lot of tuples, then the size difference of this versus this is not going to be that great, right? So, and then the reason why also too we have to store this in a separate area is that these things are going to be a different size than this. And remember, we said this is like a fixed length pool, right? So we can't embed the tombstones in the actual table itself because everything will get misaligned. But the nice thing about this approach is that when we do a sequential scan without the indexes, we'll hit all our tuples, right? So that our implementation of our iterator would have to know that, all right, I've reached the end of the regular table heap. Let me start scanning in the tombstone heap as well. All right, so this is the tombstone approach. In the bloom filter approach, we don't have any tombstones here. We can reuse these slots for new tuples as needed. And then for every single index, we're going to have a bloom filter that allows us to do a check on this first. If it's not there, then we also do a check on this. And then if we identify that it's in, we think it's in there, then there'll be a disk resident data structure that we can go fetch to find the actual block location of the tuple that we were looking for. So you can kind of think of this as like disk resident version of this to track just the data that's on disk. And so depending on what kind of index you're doing and what kind of query you're doing, you may not actually have to check the bloom filter, right? Let's say I do a primary key lookup or a unique key lookup. I get a match in my regular index. I know I don't care about anything that's in the bloom filter because it has to be unique and it's already in there. So it's definitely going to be in memory. This is from the Hackathon guys, and they also have a way, they have a variant of a bloom filter, I think it's called Arch or Arc, that allows you to do sequential scans in an approximate data structure in the same way that you can do a bloom filter, right? Because a bloom filter can only do for key lookups. If you need to do a sequential scan, then this won't work. So they have an additional data structure to deal with that problem. Okay, so now that we've evicted data out on disk, we've identified what's cold, right? And we've made a decision about how we're going to move it out the disk and what metadata we're going to maintain in memory to keep track of everything. And now we have a transaction or query that comes along and wants to access one of these evicted tuples. So how are we going to deal with this? So the first issue we have to deal with is when we go fetch the block that has the tuple that we want, remember we said because in-memory stuff is all tuple-oriented, so we can go be more fine-grained with our access methods. But when we go out to cold data storage, it's a block-based device. We're always going to get a block of data. So that means for when we need one tuple, we're going to go fetch a block that may have multiple tuples in it. So the question we have to deal with is, what do we do with those other tuples that we didn't really need? So the first approach is just only merge back into memory, into the regular table heap, the tuples that were requested, right? So the idea is that we only need one tuple in this block. We'll go grab the block that has all the data for multiple tuples, but we'll go pick out the one tuple that we want, and we'll merge that back into memory. And that also means going back and updating all the index pointers for that particular tuple to change them from pointing to the tombstone to now point to the regular tuple that's back in memory. The other approach is, all right, so to do this though, you have to maintain some extra metadata now in memory about when you excise tuples out of blocks, because now you're going to have these holes, because what you don't want is if I pull a block back in and I just grab the one tuple that I need, but then later on it becomes cold again and now I write it out to another block, I need to make sure that if I crash and try to recover from my cold disk storage, I recognize that the first one is no longer valid. It's actually the second one that I really want, because I have actually two copies of the data. All right, so there's an additional bookkeeping you have to maintain in your log when you do checkpoints and things like that for this kind of environment if you want to do this first approach. The second approach is pretty simple, right? You just go grab the block with a bunch of tuples and you merge them all back into main memory, and you don't worry about holes and you don't worry about additional bookkeeping. Now, the downside of this is obviously you're merging back in tuples that weren't really requested and are probably still cold, but you pay a CPU overhead to go update now all the indexes to now point to them back in the table heap rather than the tombstones. And then what'll happen is soon after they're merged back in, you're probably gonna run out of more memory and you're gonna have to go evict the exact same tuple you just merged back in. So you sort of have this ping-ponging effect where you're merging tuples back in, then it gets cold, and then you evict them out again, right? They're sort of getting copied back and forth over and over again, right? So these are the two issues that we have to deal with when we pull block back in. Now the question is, what do we do with the query that tried to access, or transaction that accessed the evicted data? What do we do while we fetch the data from disk that it wants? So the first approach is to abort the transaction, roll back any changes that it made, put it into a separate queue on the side, then have a background thread go fetch the block that you need, and then you can either merge the single tuple or all the tuples, it doesn't matter. And then once the data is ready and it's merged back into the table heap, you restart the transaction and let it execute again, and now when it accesses that tuple that it wanted before, it'll be in memory and doesn't have to restart. So one of the problems with this is that, well, first you assume that you're running everything as stored procedure, right? You're assuming that you're running like a VoltDB style system where you have all the program logic and queries that the transaction is going to execute directly in a stored procedure, so therefore it's really easy for you to restart. But if you're running in a procedural style system where all the program logic is on the application side in like PHP code or something else, you can't quite do this if there's a lot of intermediate steps between the different queries. Another problem with this is that you can't guarantee consistency for queries that touch a lot of data. Because let's say that I have a database or a table that's 1 gigabyte in size, but I only have 512 megabytes of RAM. And half the table is going to be in DRAM, half the table is going to be on disk. When my query starts, I scan the first half, and that's everything, all that's in memory, so there's no problems. But then now I go to the second half, and that's out on disk. So my transaction will get aborted, then the first half will be swapped out, and the second half will be brought back in. Now when I restart my query, because I have to maintain consistency, and therefore I have to start at the very beginning again, I'm going to hit the first tuple, and that's going to be evicted, and I have to do this all over again. So I'll never be able to finish this query if I do this approach, if I'm trying to guarantee strong consistency or ACID guarantees of the transaction. So that's the problem with this approach. The other approach is to do synchronous retrieval, and this is essentially what you would do. Yes, sorry.
Also affect the ordering of your transactions, because if you submit one query and another query, and the second query hits something on disk, and you abort it, the first one hits something on disk, and you abort it, and the second query is going to finish before the first one, and if you're trying to maintain like serializability or something.
So his statement is, if you have a... So you have two transactions or two queries in one transaction?
Two transactions.
Yes.
Two different queries. First one hits something on disk.
Yes.
So you abort it.
Yes.
So then the second one will finish first.
Yes.
But if you had some sort of consistency model,
that. Right. So the statement is, yeah, I have two transactions, each have one query. The first transaction hits something on disk and therefore has to be aborted. The second transaction has everything in memory, so therefore can finish. As long as the second transaction does not see anything that was modified by the first transaction, it's allowed to finish without any problems. And you still guarantee serializability.
But what if the first one was going to modify something that the second one sees? And
so the statement is, if the first one modifies something and the second one sees it?
So if I submit those two queries in a row, right? Yeah. One's an insert and one was like a scan.
Yes.
I would expect that the scan would see the insert, right?
No. Right, so like serializability just means that the queries, the transactions have to execute in some serial order, but it doesn't have to be the serial order that you submitted them as. You're referring to it as external consistency,
yeah.
Right? And that's, no database system guarantees that other than the spanner, as far as I know,
okay.
Right? Does everyone understand the issue, right? This is serializability theory. If I execute two transactions, right, and the application submits transaction number one followed by transaction number two, the database system does not have the guarantee that one will finish before two. It can actually execute them in any order at once, as long as they execute in a schedule that produces a database that is equivalent to one that was generated by transactions that ran in a serial schedule. So there's no problem with this.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, so the second approach is dealing with, is basically what a disk-based database system would do. It's like, as soon as you try to touch something that's out on disk, I stall while the I/O thread fetches the thing I need and merges it back into memory. And then once that's ready, then my transaction can pick up and keep on going. Of course, now if I'm holding locks during this time, then that just makes everybody go slower because I can't, you know, I have to wait until my data comes back into memory before I can release those locks. Right? So this is, yeah, sorry.
So if the scenario is going to be that you're going to do this long running queries and there's going to be these short queries that swap blocks out, you're going to, the aborted restart doesn't seem like a good choice there, right?
Absolutely, yeah. So the statement is, if you're doing transactions that have to touch a lot of data, and therefore you're doing this abort and restart, it's going to be a bad idea. Absolutely, yes. And so again, this is sort of why we're focusing this on OLTP, because for the most part, it's going to go grab a small number of things, right? This obviously would not work if you're doing OLAP, because you have to scan the entire table, right? But there may be a case where, again, you have a fat finger transaction where you're updating everybody's salary because you're off by one or something. In that case, you couldn't do this because you'd have the thrashing effect that I talked about before. And this is also very tightly related to the concurrency scheme that's being used. This approach might be better, although we'll see in a second that it's not. Yeah, our original hypothesis was this approach is better in a multi-B HDR style scheme because since your execution engines are single-threaded, if you have to stall them and go fetch the data that you need for a particular transaction, other transactions are waiting to acquire that lock, right? And therefore, it's better just to abort it, put it in the side queue, and then other transactions keep on going. And again, we guarantee things are still done in serializable order, so we're okay. Yeah, for OLAP, this is problematic, but we'll see in later in the class when we experiment, this actually turns out to be better, regardless of what concurrency scheme you're using. So that's the spoiler. Use this one. All right. Another interesting thing we can deal with too is also when we go grab a block with data. Before we said we can decide to merge just the single tuple or the entire block, but it may be the case that we don't actually want to merge any of it. And what I mean by that is we have the ability to say, well, this data has been is cold, or this tuple is cold, and we know this because we've evicted it out before. And chances are it's still probably cold, and therefore maybe we don't even bother merging it back in memory at all. What we'll do, we'll put it into a temporary buffer, and then let the transaction that needed it do whatever it, you know, operation it wants on it, and then when it finishes, we'll just throw it away and free the memory. And that way, if any other transaction comes along later on, then we can, you know, we'll do the same thing. But now we don't worry about using up memory for a bunch of cold data that we're going to have to go evict later on. So the first policy is to always merge the data in, right? And that's what I talked about before. The second policy is only merging tuples into the heap if they're being modified in an update query. If you're doing a delete, it doesn't matter. You just have to maintain some metadata to say that this tuple has been deleted. If you can't insert a cold tuple, right? That doesn't make any sense. So it's really only for the updates that we'll just merge back in, right? For selects, we'll bring it back in, let the query operate on it, and then just throw it away as soon as it's done. And then a selective merge is, regardless of whether it's being it's using a select or update operation, we'll make a decision about whether we should merge it back into main memory based on how that data has been used in the past. Right, so it's basically the same kind of thing where we're tracking the usage patterns of individual tuples. We can track the usage patterns of blocks as well in memory. So the idea is that we'll maintain this histogram or access frequency of the different blocks over a window, over a fixed period of time that's always moving forward. And then when we go fetch a block that's needed by a transaction, we'll look in this histogram, make a decision that how often it's been accessed before, and if it's in some kind of top threshold, then we'll merge the tuple back in because we know it's being accessed over and over again, and therefore it's probably become hot again. But if it's not above this threshold, then we just throw it away and save our memory space. And so obviously this is, you know, you don't want to have to maintain a lot of extra metadata to be able to do this. And so the way we use it, the way we do this is using another approximate data structure called a count min sketch. You can sort of think of it like as a counting Bloom filter. Right, it maintains an approximation of how many times we've seen the block in the past. All right, so those again are the main ideas, the main issues you have to deal with when you want to have larger than memory databases. So now I'm going to go through five different examples and show exactly how they line up in this taxonomy. So the first one is something that I worked on called anti-caching within HStore. And the basic idea of this is that you have a, we use Berkeley DB as a on-disk hash table. We turn off all the locks and all the other transactional stuff that Berkeley DB provides and just use it as a disk resident storage. And for this, we use an online identification where we maintain an LRU inside the tuples themselves. The administrator defines a threshold for when you want to decide to start vicking stuff. We're going to use tombstones. The initial implementation used the abort and restart retrieval policy. And then we had block-level granularity, where we would merge the entire block in, and we would always merge it in. We didn't do the selective merging that we had before. So this was the assigned reading for you guys from today's class. But I mean, the basic idea is applicable for all these other stuff as well. In Hackathon, they had this thing called Project Siberia, which I don't know whether actually made it into the commercial version. This is sort of something that came at MSR, and they have a bunch of papers about it. And so this one's going to use offline identification, where you have the log and then a background thread figures out the access frequencies of tuples. And then it's also going to use administrator-defined threshold to move data out. And they're going to use that bloom filter and on-disk storage that we talked about before. And as far as I know, they do synchronous retrieval, tuple-level granularity, and they always merge data back in, rather than trying to be selective. For EPFL, they have the researchers there took VoltDB and modified the execution engine to now actually support mmap storage instead of using the malloc storage. So they're doing the same thing that Hackathon does with the offline identification, but they're going to use virtual memory to manage moving data out. And so that means that because it's virtual memory, it's going to be synchronous because your transaction will try to access something, hit a page fault, and the OS will stall the thread while it goes and fetches the data you need. They can't do doing page level granularity. And the reason why that's different than block granularity is because they don't really control the boundaries of where tuples lie in the pages. The OS just sort of does all that for them. And then they use the always merge policy because, again, the OS doesn't allow you to control this. So again, I've derided mmap multiple times in this class. I said to put, don't use mmap in your database system on my tombstone. But what I actually think they do is actually kind of clever. So what they're going to do is they have the in-memory table heap, right? And they're going to split it up between hot storage and cold storage. And so the way it's going to work is you use mAdvise to tell the OS that this region of memory for my process is pinned. And the operating system is not allowed to evict anything that's in this part here. And so they'll maintain the log about how transactions access tuples, and then the background thread will decide that this tuple is cold and move it down to this lower region that's unpinned, where the operating system is allowed to move stuff out. So now anything that gets added to the database always ends up in this hot region, and then when it goes above some threshold that the operating system is maintaining, it'll go ahead and move it out, right? And this is all transparent to the database system itself. The OS is just doing all this for you. But it knows that this region here is it's allowed to move stuff out. So what's one possible problem with this? For anybody that's used mmap. So the problem is, if we don't know where the boundaries of pages are for in memory here, it may be the case that our tuple lands on at a memory location that spans multiple pages, right? So what happens is it's going to get split up, and then when these things get evicted, half the tuple goes out in one page, and the other half goes in the other page. So now when I do a read on this tuple, if I have to read the entire thing, then it's two separate page faults, two separate reads to go get this data and reconstruct the entire tuple. Whereas before, in our database system, when we were in anti-caching in Hackathon, since we're managing the blocks of cold tuples ourselves, we can make sure that our thing aligns exactly within a single block, and we don't have this problem. Now, this is only for tuples that fall in the boundaries of our pages here, and if we know our page size, and we try to be careful about this, so it's not for every single time you access a tuple you have to do two different page reads. It's the only ones that may cross this boundary here. So I don't think this is a huge penalty, but this is sort of one of the things you lose when you let the operating system manage your stuff for you. Okay. The next system I'll talk about is Apache Geode, and I guess full disclosure, I don't know exactly whether I'm telling you what I don't know whether exactly what I'm telling you is 100% correct, because it's very confusing, because Apache Geode, as far as I know, used to be called VMware SQL Fire, and then when they merged and created with EMCs and became Pivotal, they renamed it to GemFire, and then they now open sourced it to be a part of Apache, now as Apache Geode, and then there's this other thing that they sell called GemFire XD, which uses Apache Geode, and so I'm not exactly sure everything I'm saying is 100% correct, but this is far, when I used to read the documentation for GemFire XD before they became Geode, this is what I understood them to do. But they're doing online identification with administrative threshold, they're using tombstones with synchronous retrieval, and the way they're going to do this is that basically you say, all right, when my table gets larger than the size I want it to be, they start shoving out tuples out into a log-based structure on HDFS. And then anytime that a transaction or a query tries to access the log structured data, they will retrieve it from disk and just read it from there, unless it's being updated, which then they append it back to the log structure that's in memory. Right? So I have these question marks here because I've read the documentation a couple times for both the old version and the new version, and I think this is what they're talking about, but I probably should have contacted them. So then the last one is MemSQL. And this one's actually very different from everything we talked about today because they're bringing in cold data storage or disk storage for as a column store that's separate from the actual hot data that's in a row store system. So what I mean by that is all the mechanisms we talked about before, you have a single logical table that's exposed to the application, and the database system automatically decides how to move cold data out to disk, but then it still appears as a single logical table. In MemSQL, what happens is the administrator, when it creates a table, can specify that it should be an on-disk column store. And it'll appear to the application as a separate logical table. So using our eBay example, you would have a in-memory row store table for the hot auctions. And then after those 90 days, you would move them into the disk resident table. But if you ever wanted to do a query that spanned both tables, you would have to write a join to combine them because it appears as two separate logical tables. And so the way they implement this is using MMAP as the buffer pool. So they don't have their own LRU structures or anything like that. They just let the operating system do everything. And I think this is okay as far as I know, having thought through it a little bit. I think this might be okay for what they're doing because if you ever have to update the on-disk table, if they have an in-memory Delta store, the same that we talked about before with HANA and Hyper, and then they have a background thread that goes along and then can merge those changes into the column store stuff. And they also have the pre-computed aggregates that are always in memory that we talked about, so you don't have to go to disk to go fetch things you maybe not need. So for this case, they're not doing anything manual, or they're not doing anything automatic, either offline or online, to identify what tuples are cold. It's up to the administrator, the human, to specify this. They don't have any victim metadata because they're letting the operating system do this. It's synchronous retrieval because as soon as you try to touch the page, the operating system page falls and brings it back in. And then in case they always merge because you're doing an OLAP query on this data. So therefore, you want to put everything back in main memory in order to operate on it. And then the OS can flush it out later on. So I think this is actually kind of interesting. I'm debating mentally. I'm still debating with myself whether MMAP is a good idea or not. But they say it seems to work. All right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about a work in progress for us. It's a paper we submitted a few weeks ago on evaluating these different design decisions we have in our database system architecture in the context of HDOR with anti-caching. And I'll sort of go to the high level, some of the big takeaways we have from this. And for this, what I think is really cool about it is this work is, rather than just picking one hardware device and trying out all the different policies on it, we're actually going to do these evaluation on five different devices that all have different properties and different characteristics. So the spinning disk hard drive is the standard hard drive that people think of from the architecture of the 1970s. The shingle magnetic recording drive is a newer technology from Seagate. where it's basically a spinning disk hard drive, but they can write to the tracks more closely together on the platter. And then what happens is when you do a write, you end up overwriting the tracks that are next to you, so you have to do some extra work to repair them, but allows you to pack more data into a single drive than you would in the traditional case. Then we have a NAND flash solid state drive, like a generic SSD. And these last two here are experimental hardware from Intel that are supposed to be coming out in the near future. So 3D XPoint is their non-volatile memory device that's going to be a PCI Express. Like, think of it like a better SSD, so it's still block addressable. And then non-volatile memory or non-volatile RAM is going to be in a couple years from now, where it's going to be basically a DRAM DIMM that will have the same sort of latencies as is DRAM, just a little bit slower. But anytime you pull the power, all the data you wrote to it persists. And so to do this correctly, there's some extra CPU instructions that Intel's adding that allows you to flush cache lines directly out to the NVM. So that if that way, if you crash, you don't have your stuff sitting in your caches. Everything's been persisted. So I'm not going to say much about this today. We'll talk more about this on Wednesday's class. But this is sort of a nice segue for us, because you'll see how all this older technology is, in a block-based system, is actually going to be inferior to this if you have byte-addressable, tuple-oriented access methods that can use NVM. Yes?
Actual hardware for the
X. His question is, do we get actual hardware for XPoint? The answer is no. So this is, I guess I can say this, it's a, both of these are hardware emulated. So it's basically, for this one, they made a special PCI Express card that has DRAM on it. You pull the plug, everything goes away, so it's not actually durable, but it's, they've tweaked the hardware such that the latencies mimic what the real thing can actually do. And in this case here, what happens is, they actually put hooks in the motherboard for the debug methods for the memory controller, so that when you read and write to DRAM in this special mode, there's a little busy loop that spins it for a little bit to slow it down, as if it was actually really NVM. So Intel says that this is coming later this year. This one, they always say it's 2 years, but I mean, people have been saying that since 2008 or since, even before that. It's always 2 years. We'll talk about more about the disappointing timelines for these guys next class. But this is stuff we're actively working on. All right, so the first thing we're going to do is sort of a micro benchmark that evaluates these different devices for a workload that is representative of a database system reading and writing evicted tuples back and forth from DRAM to disk. All right, so we're going to break it up between doing 1 kilobyte reads, sort of accessing a single tuple, or a 64 kilobyte read and write that's accessing a block of tuples. So as expected, as you go across from the older drive devices to the newer stuff, the performance gets much better. But the two kind of things I want to point out here is the spinning disk hard drive and the shingled magnetic disk drive, their read speeds are basically the same, and this is expected because they're basically the same technology. But in the shingled magnetic disk drive, the writes are much slower because it's more expensive to do write to a track because you have to repair the other tracks that get overwritten that are near it. And then over here, we see that the NVRAM stuff and the DRAM is actually very, very close to each other. And this is expected because the NVRAM is expected to be about 4x slower latencies than DRAM. So this sort of lines up exactly what we're seeing here. So you see that the accessing a single kilobyte, so think of that as a single tuple in cold data storage, on NVRAM is roughly the same as DRAM, whereas all these other guys, it's much, much slower. So what I'm getting at is, in next class, we'll see that you can design a database system to treat NVRAM just as if it was an extended version of DRAM, and you avoid all the slowness of using a block-oriented API or block-oriented architecture to do cold disk storage or cold data storage if you have that kind of storage device. Again, we'll talk about more of that on Wednesday. All right, so for this graph, I want to show, we're evaluating the merging threshold policies. Remember, this was, I keep track of how often a block has been used, and I make a decision whether to merge everything back into memory or to maintain or put the data into a temporary buffer and blow it away when the transaction that accesses it finishes it. So we have doing the merge only when a tuple is updated, And then if top 5%, top 20% is when the tuple is actually is in the top 5% or 20% of all tuples accessed in some time window. And the merge all approach is basically you always merge everything back in. And I think for this we're doing tuple level granularity instead of block granularity. So the first thing to point out is for the spinning disk hard drive and the shingled magnetic disk drive, using the the AR stands for abort and restart, and SR is the synchronous retrieval. For these guys over here, the synchronous retrieval is always faster, but we wanted to evaluate to see whether the abort and restart works better on a system like HDOR. And what we see is actually it's not the case at all. So if you do the synchronous retrieval, even though the disk drives are actually kind of slow, stalling the transaction and waiting is actually the better way to go. Right? Because if you're doing selective merging, then you're not always merging the tuple back in, and therefore you're not paying this big penalty to update the indexes all the time. So this is basically saying that the CPU cost of merging cold data back in outweighs the cost of actually going and reading it. But we can compare all these different storage devices versus DRAM, which is this line here. So this is what the speed of the data system would be if everything fits in DRAM. And as you can see, for these guys over here, for these newer non-volatile memory technologies, we're pretty close there. So the next thing you want to compare is sort of, say, a generic configuration that sort of is a catch-all for all possible storage devices versus a configuration that's optimized for each individual storage device. So this sort of goes back to what the original anti-caching paper that you guys read was about, right? It had this configuration here, but now we're going to have one that's actually designed for the hardware that we're using. And so for this, we're going to look at two workloads. The first one is going to be the TATP benchmark. I think the paper might call it TM1 benchmark. And this is basically a workload from Ericsson that mimics people driving down the highway with their cell phone, and you have to update the cell phone tower to say, you know, what tower is the closest to you, so when a call comes in, you know how to route it. And so for this workload here, we see quite a significant difference between the storage devices using the generic version versus the optimized version. And what we see is that in the case of the NVRAM case, we're almost as good as being exactly, you know, entirely in DRAM. Right? So for this particular workload here and its access patterns, we see it having the speed of the device makes a big difference in the performance of the systems you can get. Right? This is the slowest, and then this is the fastest. Right? But it's not always this case, right? If you have a particular workload that doesn't have the properties that the TATP benchmark has, then you don't see a huge difference. And that's what the second workload is here. So this is called the voter benchmark. I think we talked about this before. This was designed by VoltDB to mimic the access patterns of American Idol kind of application. So you have people calling on the phone or going online voting for contestants that they like on the TV show. So for this workload, it's very insert heavy. And so that means basically what's happening is we're just inserting to our database over and over again, and then we're just evicting all that data out in the background, and we never have to go back and read it again. So in that case here, you don't actually see any major difference in performance of these different devices, right? Because you're almost never having to go back and fetch cold data. Right, so the main takeaway to get from all this is that if you have a workload that does have to access cold data a lot, and the access pattern is very skewed, then having a better storage device does make a big difference, and treating it and using it correctly makes a big difference. But if you're never actually reading the cold data and you're just always evicting, mixing stuff as it comes in, then there's no difference at all. So, any questions about this? Yes.
Why is optimized lower performance than the generic?
Yeah, I see that. Yeah. So his question is, why is this higher than this?
Yeah, and in SMR as well.
We need to be able to check this. Yeah, like I said, it's under submission. We need to go look at that. Yes. Okay. Again, the reason why I want to show these results is that it's going to set us up for Wednesday's class. So all of this stuff we talked about today is about how to have the database system work around the slowness and complications of dealing with a block-based device, storage device, when we have a tuple-oriented or tuple, you know, a byte-addressable database system architecture, right? We want to bring blocks back in without having all the buffer pool crap we had before. But if you have non-volatile DRAM, non-volatile memory, sometimes storage class memory, persistent memory, and it's cheap and fast enough, or close to the speed of DRAM, then all the crap that we talked about today is completely goes out the door, and you don't need to do any of it. Because we'll see on Wednesday, you can design a system to use NVRAM as an extension to the database system's address space. And that means you can have, you know, half your database in DRAM, half your database in NVM, and all the execution engine stuff that we talked about before can just point to data in NVM and doesn't need to worry about fetching blocks in or managing all that other crap, right? It just extends the address space of memory and everything runs really fast. And we'll see why a in-memory architecture that we've been talking about in this class for the last semester is in a better position to use this new NVM stuff when it finally comes out than the MySQLs and Oracles of the world. Because they'll treat NVRAM as just sort of a faster SSD, but if you treat it as truly what it is, byte addressable memory that's persistent, then you can get much better performance. So again, I don't think that's gonna happen until, you know, for 5 years or so, but we can talk about, we can design systems now to take advantage of it when it finally comes along. Okay, so any questions about this stuff? Yes. Yes. Correct.
You still have the same problem.
So his statement is, unless your NVRAM stuff is as big as the storage capacity you can get now in today's disks, then you're still going to have these problems. Yes, and so depending on whether you believe the manufacturers or not, right? When HP announced memristors, they were talking about 1 petabyte of storage per square centimeter, right? That was 2008. It hasn't arrived yet. We'll talk about how, you know, again, I'm not a chip manufacturer. I don't do computer engineering stuff, but we can talk about how 3D, you know, stacking, things like that can maybe be able to allow them to achieve that. And this is essentially where they're going. If NVRAM is not very big in the very beginning, then you still have to do all the stuff. So that's what I'm saying. Unnecessary in 10 years. How about that? Any other questions? All right, so again, next class we'll talk about the new non-volatile memory stuff. And this is sort of like, there was two lectures I wanted to do, but unfortunately we had to cut some of the classes. There's two lectures I wanted to do on sort of experimental memory hardware. There was the non-volatile memory stuff and the hardware transactional memory work. I would say that this is gonna have a bigger impact on how we design database systems than the hardware transactional memory. It's been out for a while. The hardware transactional memory has been out for a while, and I think Intel has some bugs in it and things like that. And as far as I know, nobody actually uses it, but all the major database vendors are chomping at the bit to get this, because I think this is gonna be a bigger game changer. And then also talk about at the end about what's expected and the guidelines for doing the code reviews for project number 3, okay? Awesome, guys. See you on Wednesday.